now want to give you a short comparison between containers and virtual machines. And containers boot much faster than classic VMs because they already have a kernel running up and it's just a simple virtualization of what's already existent instead of booting up a whole.
My name is Eddie, and we're here at Web Engineering 2019 in lovely Palma, Mallorca, Spain. We've met so many amazing people. The Dashboard Hub team have really been speaking to everyone and has really got stuck in and helped out. And people have already asked if they're going to come next year, so it's been great. An unconference is where there's no planned talks. People turn up on the day and propose talks they would like to give. So it was really, really interesting. It was so good and so many great talks, and we videoed them. Subscribe to my channel below so when the videos do come out from the talks, you get notified of those videos. It wasn't just about coding. It was also about soft skills, a whole variety. Body language, how to present at a talk, how to present at a meeting, how you can change your coding to reduce the impact on climate change. So tech is for everyone. Tech is for you.
Welcome to that Docker crash course. Maybe to give you an overview why I created that presentation. In our company, or especially in my team, Grapolis from InnoGames, we are using Docker for our local development environment. The people are using it, but most people didn't understand what it is, how it works, and yeah, so I wanted to give them an insight of it. So let's dive into it. We are using Docker containers. What is a container? A container is like a user space that is completely isolated from the host system that gives the security that nobody can breach out of a container and maybe leak some data from the host system. And there are several tools on the different operating systems to do that. There's Docker for all operating systems. On Windows, you might have heard Hyper-V as virtualization software. On Linux, there's ChangeRoot, which is also the main tool which Docker uses to change the environment of a user. Then there's LXC, I think it's Linux something containers, OpenVZ, systemd, nspawn, and so on. So on Linux, you have the most threaded tools and the best choice, or the widest choice. On macOS, I know about Docker and ChangeRoot, but I don't know if there's anything else on Mac. You said Docker for Mac, but that is using, I think, VirtualBox together with Docker in it as an image. And containers are based on images. What is an image? Now I want to give you a short comparison between containers and virtual machines. Before Docker, there was VirtualBox, for example, where you could just create an image and spin up a whole operating system. So you had the whole Ubuntu, for example, in that image. And on containers or with containers, you don't have the operating system in the image anymore. You just have the files it needs to run. And containers interact with the kernel of the host system. Classic VMs act like they are single computers. They have their simulated hardware and graphics interface, network interface, and so on. And the goal of a container is to fulfill only one purpose. So it's not the best idea to, if you have like a web application, let's say a shop or a WordPress, whatever, to put the database, the web server, and everything into that one container. That's not the purpose, but you would do that with a virtual machine, maybe. And containers boot much faster than classic VMs because they already have a kernel running up and it's just a simple virtualization of what's already existent instead of booting up a whole operating system. Yeah, but how can we create those containers with Docker? And the keyword there is images. And images are built up from several layers. And we have a series of layers, as you can see at the image on the bottom. And each layer represents an instruction in our Docker file. And I have a very small Docker file here, which is inheriting from an existing Ubuntu image with version 15.04. The next command is copying something, our working directory, to /app in the container. And then there's another command. We are making the app. And navigating in CMD means that is the command that the container is executing when it's starting. So we have basically four layers here. And you can see that on the right, each command has one layer. And the first one is the most bottom container. And that is 180 something megabytes, because that's part of the operating system and kind of huge. Then we are copying the stuff in, almost 200 kilobytes. We are making the app that takes about 2 megabytes and so on. Running that command doesn't really do anything from with the space it's using. On top of each image, when the container is booting, or when you create a new container, Docker automatically creates a really thin read-write layer. And that's basically what your persistence layer is when you start that container. But please don't confuse that with volumes. We'll come to that. So the top writable layer. As you can see here, we have that one Ubuntu image, and we have 4 containers that are using that image. That means it uses that image and just puts on this thin read-write layer in order to have some kind of persistence there. But you only have that image once, which saves you a lot of disk space. When the container is deleted, that also means that the read-write layer is deleted, and that's normally the only thing that gets deleted. And the underlying image remains unchanged, so you can reuse it for next containers. And I already talked about data volumes. So in most cases, you need some kind of persistence that also remains when you stop the container, when you delete it, or whatever. And therefore, you have the data volumes. And you can basically mount every folder or file that is in a container onto your hard disk or onto your host system. And then it creates automatically a data volume. That also means when the container is deleted, that data volume still keeps the same because that's on your hard drive, on your host system, and you can mount it to any other container again. You can also mount one volume to multiple containers. That is also no problem to share the data. Then some things about the Docker CLI and Docker Compose, just a short comparison. Here's an example of Docker Compose. So if nobody of you knows what Docker Compose is. It's a tool for defining and running a whole set of containers and Docker applications. It makes interacting with the containers much more comfortable because you have your whole definition of your, I wouldn't say cluster, but setup in one file. Here you can, for example, see that we have a service that is called DB that uses the Postgres image. You can expose some ports from inside to the outside of the host, of the container, and you can define environment variables, volumes, and so on. There are lots of more possibilities. And Compose has commands for managing the whole lifecycle of your application. You can start, stop, rebuild, view the status of running services, see the log files or the std out, std error from the containers that is passed to Docker, or just run a command against one container and exit after that. And here's just a comparison between how you would set up that setup with the normal Docker CLI. Yeah, there you have to define the whole environment variables and so on with one command. And here you have it in one file. And you can even define multiple services here. So if you want to run an Nginx, for example, you can just write that in your Docker Compose and spin it up with Docker Compose up. And with a normal CLI, you would have to run a new Docker run it Nginx, whatever. So I think Docker Compose is much more comfortable. To give you an overview about why it's a bit more comfortable, on the left side you can see the Docker CLI commands you would need to run the Docker Compose stuff. So we had that here on the previous slide. Starting a container, you have to define everything in the command. With Docker Compose up, you just need the Docker Compose YAML file, but then you can just spin it up. Docker PS and Docker Compose PS don't give each other much. But to bash into a container, so to have the command line of one container and in your command line, you would have to run search for the Docker ID or the container ID, and then execute with that second command, docker exec IT, and then the ID or full name, and then bash. And with Docker Compose, you can just simply use the name you defined in the YAML file, which I also find a bit better to recognize. And stopping the single container is the same. You have to at first find the ID and then run stop. And for the Docker Compose stuff, you can just use Docker Compose stop or down, which would remove the container. The benefits of containerizing applications, in my opinion, at first the security. I mean, you have to be aware of security, and it's much harder for attackers to breach out of a container instead of when you don't have Docker and you have all the services running on one machine. It might be possible that the attackers could have access to the database when they found a hole in the PHP application or whatsoever. Yeah, but you still have to have a bit of knowledge in order to make Docker really secure. Just writing a Docker file doesn't say that your application is secure. Less overhead, you don't have the whole operating system in your images. That saves a lot of space. You can reuse images, which also saves a lot of space. It just saves space comparing to virtual machines. Flexibility, it's very easy to spin up new containers or exchange single services in a setup, and because containers don't need a lot of time for booting, it's very fast to just exchange services or containers. And speed, with speed I don't mean that the application gets faster or something, but it's just that the containers don't need much time to spin up. You're very flexible in programming or defining the Docker Compose files, writing like a, how is it called, a spin-up script for a virtual machine and test it. That's much more easier with just writing a Docker file. Thank you very much for attending and listening, and have a nice day.